Well, hello, 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 and welcome once again to 25 O'Clock. I'm your host, Dan Drago. Thanks for being here. Thanks for joining me on the show. This week, my guest, Brian Erickson from the band The Paper Jets. Brian is no stranger to the show. He's been on a couple times before under other projects and circumstances, but it was great to have him for his own. This is the one. This is the Brian Erickson episode. All Brian Erickson, all the time. For this episode, we'll talk more about Brian in just a minute. But thanks for joining me. Thanks for listening. Thanks to all the people who listened and sent me messages about the last episode, which was my fall music compilation, where I highlighted, I think it's 11 bands / artists, all in the Philadelphia area, and music they had out. It was a fun episode to put together. I really had a great time. And I actually really had a great time going back and listening to it like it wasn't me, like it was just a cool little radio show that I was like, oh, listen to this music that I'd never heard of before. It was fun to do that as well. So if you missed it or you want to listen to it again, you should go to 25oclockpod.com. You can stream it and download it there. You can also stream and download any and all episodes. And you can check out the Friends and Neighbors page. That's where I link anyone and everyone who's ever been on the show. Go around, sign up for the mailing list, find us on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and all that fun stuff. That's the show. That's the site. That's the site for the show is what it is. 25oclockpod.com. Hope to see you there. Just a brief recap, just in my general comings and goings. Just got back from being in the studio for a large part of the weekend up in Rochester, New York at 1809 Studios, which is also my brother's studio, working on a new record for a group that I've been part of. It's called The Monroes, and it's just sort of a fun studio project between myself, my childhood best friend, James Hearn, my brother Dave, and my good friend Jake Walsh. And that was fun to do. It was fun to see those guys, and it was fun to play with them. And that record will probably come out in early 2019. We're not entirely certain when. But yeah, that's what's been going on with me. And, you know, just living, enjoying the fall weather, enjoying life, getting ready for Thanksgiving, all that fun stuff. But let's talk about Brian. Brian Erickson of The Paper Jets. You can check them out at thepaperjets.com. That was easy. Good job, guys. Good job being able to just nab the exact domain that you needed, thepaperjets.com. I said that Brian has been on the show a couple of times before. His first appearance, he was part of a live show that I did at the Philadelphia Podcast Festival in 2016. That's episode 50. He shares the show with Ben Hughes, I believe, another guy who I love having on the show more than once. And then Brian came back on with his podcast co-host partner, Bill Lambusta. They both host a podcast called The Great Albums Podcast, which I have been on a couple of times. That's in episode 71. But here it is. It's the all Brian Erickson episode. And the Paper Jets have a new record coming out. It's called Every Day Forever. It's going to be out December 7th, which is also the day of their record release show at Asbury Lanes, Friday, December 7th. It's going to be great. It is their last record, and as the band has put it, it is their last show ever, or so they say. Brian and I talk more about that in the conversation, but if you are in or around the Asbury Park area, you should go up to Asbury Lanes on December 7th and see the Paper Jets and their final show and the release of their new record, Every Day Forever, which I've heard a handful of songs off it, and they're outstanding. It's gonna be a great record. You're really, really going to like it. So let's just get right into it, get into my conversation with Brian Erickson of The Paper Jets here on 25 O'Clock.
No, I'm bringing the small handful of things I know about Philadelphia. I can tell you about, like, Philly Boy Roy, like Kurt Vile.
Yep.
The War on Drugs, their record was really good.
It was, yeah, that was fun. It was, I found with them, I don't know if I've said this.
Well, I have a good association with that record. Let's see, what do you got?
No, I like it fine. I think it's a good accomplishment. I'm friends with a lot of the people involved in that record. Like,
yeah, yeah. Have you met Grand Duciel?
Yeah, but way long ago, before.
No, I mean, so what?
Yeah, and like I know the production. Some of the people worked on production on that record and things like that. And it's a great record, and it's amazing. And I'm so happy it won a Grammy. It does that. Helps not that we need validation, but it does. It validates the Philly thing, and these guys who like they didn't just show up here
and
2 years
like
ago
indie
and win
rock
a Grammy.
Too, yeah. Like the fact that you know, say, like the Suburbs,
yeah,
won Album of the Year, the Arcade Fire. Yeah. For those not familiar, but a couple years ago they won like Album of the Year. That's
yeah.
Just think about this: Steely Dan's shitbox comeback album beat the Marshall Mathers LP, which it had yeah. no business doing.
Nah, not at all.
But now flip the script 10 years after that, the Arcade Fire are winning Grammys on an indie label. And yeah. that's a big... To me, and I understand the Philly, the local validation, yeah. but just indie rock at large, yeah. that's wonderful.
Yeah. I think to me in the end, as War on Drugs has continued to make records, I have found myself drifting from... them with each record, not because the records, if you were to ask me, I would say objectively the records are getting better and better.
I love
but
that
it's
first
not,
one, though.
But it's not working for me. And this new one that won the Grammy, I listened to it when it came out. I'm like, this is cool. This is clean. This is a remarkable piece of production. It, for me personally, I'm like, it did nothing for me other than for me to listen to it and be like, okay, like, yeah, but other people absolutely love it and they can pick it apart and it really works for them. And that is the nature of art.
Yeah, yeah. You know?
It's like, because I never want to talk bad, because I certainly am not talking bad on War on Drugs.
Okay, you just said
yeah.
they make good records and each one gets better.
And I just...
like so.
And so maybe there's something broken in me. I don't know. But
no,
every time they come out with it, although I really did like their cover of Touch of Grey on the...
brilliant.
And what a
good way to kick that thing off.
When I read the original like listing of that record before, like when they were... talking about it and saying like, oh, you know, the National doing this song and these people doing this song. And I remember reading in the article, said like, and War on Drugs will cover Touch of Grey. And I snidely said out loud, of course they are. Because I'm like, the most innocuous Dead song. And yeah, fine, they're going to do it. But they did a phenomenal job with it. I was like, I actually give a shit about this song.
Hey,
this
you know
great.
What? You know what it is? If that Bob Dylan and the Dead thing worked out, yeah. that's probably what it would have sounded like.
Let's talk about you. We're just talking about records. I mean, you just came from a taping, so you're
that's
in the
funny.
Mode.
Yeah, no. We just came from doing a Tuesday Night Music Club.
Oh, nice.
That's by Sheryl Crow.
That's a great record.
It is.
Yeah,
it really is.
Yeah. But you are here because there is a Paper Jets record.
There is.
And you're here just because also I like you to be here. But
I'm so happy and I'm so and I want to I don't want to I don't want to make your listeners feel as though I am more important than I am. I asked to come on.
Yeah.
I did not. You weren't like, hey,
yeah.
The situation with Brian Erickson is not that he gets asked to do things.
That he asks.
It's that he, you know, is that he tries to be as polite as possible to others. Not with the express purpose of one day he's going to ask you to do something.
Yeah.
But more just like, hey, man.
Yeah.
You mind if I come on and talk about at least drop a date on you?
Yeah. But that's that's how it works. And the longer I spent making records and being in bands and even just doing this show, the more you realize that like the stuff that happens, if you want it to happen, you just in the end you just got to ask, because like very rarely is someone going to invite you to the party. They don't know you. Like
what? If I could admit a huge fault. Which you're going to, I apologize. Because when we get to talking, like I just disarm myself a lot of the time. I am egregiously jealous of the people that get asked to do things.
And every once in a while when I do get asked to do things, it's like really awesome. But I also understand in my mind that like, that's not how it works every time.
Yeah, like, but like the people that are cool enough that they don't have to do anything. Yeah. How do you get that?
I think you probably had to do something at some point to get there. Maybe. I don't know.
I mean, yeah, maybe. But it's like, how do I get, you know, how do I get that all the time?
How do I get asked? Yeah.
How do I get asked to do things?
For me, it's like, how do I split it 50-50 to like, sometimes I'm asking and sometimes I'm being asked. But it's, yeah, for me, it's always, I do more asking than getting asked.
And you know what's interesting too is like a lot of the time people ask me, like, I like getting asked to do things, but it's kind of funny because like if I don't always like being asked, it's very, I hate to say, because some people say it's bullshit, but I feel like I'm a Gemini a lot of the time, because sometimes I'm like, oh yeah, no, I'll just talk to you about things, you know, you want to know, like, yeah, I'll talk to you about like my family and hang ups I have, you know, my daddy issues and stuff. But then other times I'm like, why are you asking me that?
Yeah, I don't understand sometimes how some people, and I don't think it's that some people get stuff just handed to them all the time, but they're always on the top of the list where it's like, hey, we need X, be that a band or a musician or whatever. And you kind of look up and be like, well, those people are getting asked again, or this same, you know, group of five people or five groups get
like,
asked again.
Like, how do I get in the club,
it's
man?
Like, how do I do that? But I think you're like me where I'm like, but I genuinely want to be in the club. Like, I don't want to just be in the club to, you know, get asked to do the cool stuff, although I'd like to do the cool stuff. It's like, I just want to be,
be
in the room.
You know what it is? Because you know what you do has value.
Yeah.
And you know that if people just saw what you do, they would also believe that what you do has value.
Yeah.
And so, but it's also like, as I get older, it's like, how many fucking times do I have to be like, hey guys, hey guys, you know?
Yeah. Or for me too, it's like, how many things do I have to go to? Just tell me the number of things and then I will reduce that by half.
And I sound so bitter, and I'm not, I'm really not.
Yeah.
Because I continue to go to things and I continue to, you know, on occasion get asked to do things, but not nearly as often as I'd like to.
Do you find sometimes the things you do get asked to do, and I won't make you name anything because I won't, but there are times when I am asked to do things,
is B-list shit. Yeah,
not even B-list, but I look at it, I'm like, it's disorganized, or I'm like, you don't even know why you want this.
Yeah.
Like,
oh yeah. All
I've been
time.
In interview situations where people have come to pick my brain about, particularly about podcasting, because it's such a nebulous, but possibly lucrative, maybe, who knows?
It's not lucrative. It's have sponsors. No. It's not lucrative.
I have no sponsors.
And I'm not bragging. Yeah. I'm just giving you the real.
Yeah,
it's not lucrative.
No.
I have no money. But, we have no money. Bill has no money. We're fucking broke.
I have no money from the podcast. I have money from my day job.
I mean, I have money from my day job that goes to people to whom I owe money. So it's like, I don't have money.
But like, I will get, people will want to pick my, it's like, oh, I want to have you on and talk to you about podcasting. And I'm like, all right, cool. And then the answer, you ever find sometimes when you, or like when people come and it's like, oh, I want to pick your brain about being in a band or songwriting.
Nobody
then,
picks my brain about being in a band, Dan.
Oh, really?
Ever. No.
What are we doing now?
Well, I guess that's, I don't know. I asked you, so you tell me. But
yeah, but like when, but then when you give answers to things that are not the answers that people wanted or that they thought you wanted to give, and then you feel bad, but also not, because you're just like, I'm telling you the truth. Like if someone were to ask you, it was like, Brian, as a podcaster, do you make a lot of money? You'd be like, no, absolutely not. Like you could watch a certain person just be crushed and disappointed by that.
Well, I mean, I could tell them how much if they really want. And, you know,
like
to
when
some,
people ask
to
you, like,
some
yeah.
that would be a lot of money, and to others it wouldn't. And maybe by comparison, you know, I also work a day job. So to me, in the comparison is that's not a whole lot of money.
Yeah.
It's not a lot of, you know, if I had that money, that might get me through, like, you know, if I had that money and lost my job, that might get me through like a month if I really, really scaled it back.
Yeah. Yeah. But anyway,
if that's any indication of the amount of money that a, you know, small-ish to maybe the bottom end of mid-level podcast might make in sponsorship money.
Yeah, it's remarkable what people think, what people's estimation of success is.
But because people know who, like, Joe Rogan is, so they know who Marc Maron is, they heard Serial.
Yeah.
And, you know, But for those three, there's like 3 million others. Well,
and I think I brought this stat up before, and this doesn't have to be all about podcasting, but I remember reading somewhere that like when Serial came out, they just like, it was the highest listened to podcast ever. They're like, 1 million people listened to Serial. Like, I like, this is sort okay. of a, and I'm like, and then the article made a very important point being like, there are 270 million people in this country. So the most successful podcast that received numbers that no one's ever seen before right off the bat was like 1/270th of people, you know, and like,
or you know, 3/10 of 1%.
Yeah, it's just something,
of the population.
Something obscene. So when people just like every, so when, you know, because when Serial came out, people were constantly coming up to, you know, me and probably other podcasts, be like, have you heard this podcast? Everyone's listening to it. And I'm just like, I'm glad to see that the number is in fact that no, everyone was not listening to it.
And you know, good on Serial for even getting that.
Yeah. I found the subject matter to be somewhat, I don't know, I have...
Well, true crime is a very
true crime is sort
thing
of,
right now.
Yeah, but it's sort of exploitative in that way, and
yeah,
I don't
think so.
And I don't care. I do like true crime, and I think there is a way to do true crime that isn't exploitative, but I don't think that they intended to do it, and that's not at all the direction or conversation I want to have about Serial. I don't. In the end, I don't care.
2 hours later. So in the end, Serial, you know, it had its flaws.
Look, we have to see both sides of Serial.
And it's like,
Serial,
and at
right?
the end, and Brian, you got that record, right?
Yeah. Good stuff. All right. Everyone buy it. Bye. I wanted to go back though because you've been on the show a few times before. You've been on you did a brief live one
over 2 years ago.
Yeah,
now.
And then you were on with Bill
talking about
the podcast. And I've been on your show a couple of times, and
you were on my talk show too.
I was on the talk show.
So happy
that was
you
a
came
lot
on
of
the
fun.
Talk show.
I was so incredibly tired and punchy when I did that, and then I remember sitting on the couch. And I remember finally like kind of dialing into the interview and then looking up and your producer was wandering around back and forth, like clearly looking at the time. And I don't think that he meant to do it to put me off, but there was this moment where I was also almost very Dan, which like I almost just broke the fourth wall, looked at the camera and just been like, is there a problem? Do I need to go faster? Are you okay? Like,
No. I control the pace. Like, they'll
I'm
give
sure
me,
too, but like
they'll throw me like the fiver. They'll throw me the wrap it up. And honestly, like,
and
I'll
just
kind of
wave it off.
Well, no, sometimes I do. You know, they'll signal the curveball, and I'll nod it off. Like, so, and I mean, I thought our interview was very sort of. And dude, we could sit for
well,
hours.
No, and when I went and watched it later, I caught the one moment where I could see in my eyes, I'm like, this is the moment where I decided whether or not to derail this whole thing by just being a dick for a second.
I mean, you could have.
And
it would not have offended me.
And I'm glad I didn't. But there was that moment, and I don't. And I know it had been sort of a trying technical evening too, just to make it happen.
Well, because we had changed locations quickly
and
I
felt
with little notice.
And
so
I felt bad, and I was trying to be as patient and trying to also not let the vibe of that affect me, because as a guy who has been on the other side of that in many other aspects, I would think to myself, I was like, this could just fill me with anxiety, despite the fact that it is not my responsibility in any way. And I had this moment. My brother has said this before,
Thank
too.
Thank you for being anxious for me.
Yeah.
Damn.
My brother, who's also a producer, has said this when he's been in situations where things are like that are happening, and he does this kind of Zen thing where he says to himself, like, none of this is any of my concern. And he's like, and if he's like, he just says, like, none of this is within my power to fix, and were I able to fix this right now, I wouldn't, because it's not my job. And then you just sit down and just go,
that's very that's very serenity prayer of him.
And kind of nihilist too, but
in its own way.
Well I mean you know, this is a guy who runs his own thing, and you've been booking shows and like running nights and stuff like that. Sometimes when you're at when you're in other situations as a spectator, and you can tell something's off.
Well, sometimes you want to step in.
And
I have at times where I've felt
so
it was appropriate,
yeah.
where I've gone to the person who might be a friend and say, hey, look,
do you need help?
who's in the sound booth? Oh, no, well, they're late. They're doing this. They're doing that. what's the deal that, why is that amp crackling?
Yeah.
Like, I got one, you know, I got a hot rod in the car that's an amp. Yeah. Not to you, but I don't know. I don't know. The listener, like, what's a hot rod in the car? You have a car in the car? But it's like, yeah, I got like a hot rod DeVille in the car real quick. You know, I'll just go run and grab
that for you.
What do you need? Yeah. Like, tell me what you need. You know, I always keep, like, I got a couple cables, like a couple SM50, you know, just stuff like that, that I just sort of always keep on hand, like in the car, in the trunk, whatever, you know, knock around stuff that, you know, is, you know, it can stand heat or cool or whatever, that can just live there for just such an occasion. It's like, what do you need?
Yeah.
You know, it's like, yeah, okay, I paid $10 to get in, but like, what do you need?
Yeah.
You know,
but that's the joy of like being part of a music community, though, is that like, you know, these people, and in the end,
you get a whiskey out of it.
Yeah. And also in the end, like, their
success and satisfaction. Yeah,
the success of your community's shows is success for everybody.
Correct.
So in the end, you're just like, well, this is just goodwill. Like, this is just what we do as being sort of, you know, statesmen of the scene in whatever way.
And sometimes it's been like, I've had, you know, I write for a website called youdontknowjersey.com. And I used to write a column, and then I kind of got tired of writing the column, and I just started reviewing records and, you know, interviewing bands and stuff like that. And my editor, when, you know, but thinking about the community, was like, oh yeah, this band, I think it was Levy and the Oaks, who were actually formerly a band called Socratic, an old drive-through records band,
an old
pop punk band from like the 2000s. But they were playing a show I was at. My editor texted me. He's like, hey, can you get some pictures of these guys? Because we're doing a feature on them tomorrow. So I need them like now. And I'm just like, yeah, man, no problem. Yeah. Like, I'm here.
Phone,
I mean, I'm like, I don't have a camera, but he's like, iPhone will do. I just need something. He's like, you know, get in their faces, like, get something decent if you can. But, you know, you do it.
Yeah.
And that's the thing. Like, you do what you can to help out.
Yeah. So let's, we'll go about this in a roundabout way.
Of course.
Because that's the way that we know how to do it. We'll skip the recap on your bio because you've been on the show before, but you're originally from Long Island.
Yeah.
And you went to college, and that was sort of your musical awakening time. Like, you've told me before on the show and in conversation that, you know, you were into music, like you liked bands and stuff like that.
Yeah, I wasn't huge into. I was a big jazz fan.
Yeah.
In high school.
Yeah, but you had told me in college is when you started to get your sort of accelerated education in indie rock, and also like the sort of the classic pop rock era from the 60s on, like your Beatles, your Beach Boys, your Stones.
You know what did stuff. It for me?
Hmm.
It was Ben Folds.
That makes a lot of sense.
Because no, what it was though was even more so than just the like not just the influence, but being like, okay, Ben Folds, he played in, you know, it's Ben Folds 5. And like, you hear him like cover a song. He covered Say Yes by Elliott Smith.
Yeah.
And then I'm like, well, who's this Elliott Smith cat who covered 13 by Big Star? And that's Alex Chilton who sang The Letter. Oh, I know that song. My dad used to play me that song, you know. And then you kind of go, and from there, and then you say, okay, well, Ben Folds, and I went deep. Like, Ben Folds was in a band in college with this dude who was in this other band with this guy who had a brief solo career and covered Last Goodbye. Like, I saw him live. He covered Last Goodbye by Jeff Buckley.
Yeah.
And then holy shit, that opens everything.
Yeah.
And then you see, like, Jeff Buckley, like, oh, there he is doing Kangaroo. And I'm like, oh, well, there's Big Star again. But now Jeff Buckley, then you've got Leonard Cohen, then you got Nina Simone, then you got Malia Jackson, Benjamin Britten, Nusrat Fateh Ali Khan, and, you know, Bob Dylan. And that's how I got to Bob Dylan, though.
Oh, wow.
That's how I got to Bob Dylan.
That is a roundabout way.
But But to be like, hear Buckley do just like a woman, and then go, wow, who's that? Like, who's B. Dylan? I mean, I knew
who
Dylan was, but I mean, you see what I mean.
Yeah.
But that's how it's. So those are the, you know, rock and roll dots.
Yeah.
And if I had a chance to really like write the tree out, I could figure out how much I gleaned from just figuring out Ben Folds.
Yeah.
And, you know, whatever bands or collaborators he had had over the years and where they sort of went and who they, you know, who they might have covered live or whatever, and then where that all went. But yeah, Ben Folds, that's how it started.
That's Magnetic North, at least for, but bringing it back in. So you're in college, and that's, I guess, I want to get to the jump for like, because you weren't originally a guitar player either, or even a songwriter.
No, I played saxophone.
Yeah, you were a saxophonist, and you
and somehow, not a singer.
Yeah, and you somehow found your way into a group of guys at in college who had a band, and you somewhere in there, like the switch flipping, you're just like, oh, well, maybe I'll try doing this too.
It's funny, too, because the switch flipped, but it took a really long time.
It was a long, long flip.
Because I look at, you know, if you think about, and I listen back to my early dorm room, and people are like, oh, wow, you're writing songs when you're like 21 years old. Because to me, getting a guitar was nothing more than a vehicle for writing songs. It's like I knew something was kicking around, and I'm like, I got to figure out how to unlock this, or got to figure out that I'm just lying to myself and it's not going to work.
Yeah.
But I didn't really, to me, as a songwriter, it took probably seven or eight years for me to start getting to a point where I'm like, oh, I'm going to write some songs that I'm going to play forever.
Yeah.
Because I look back at those early songs, even, you know, I have a new band now that's going to carry forward, but my band, the Paper Jets, who are making the record, putting out the record, we did an entire album that we decided when it was done, like we never mixed it, but when we finished recording, we were like, you know what? Skip. Hired a producer, went to a studio, spent a lot of money that we didn't have.
Yeah.
And made an entire, we recorded 14 songs and not a single one. We decided, we just said, you know what? Never mind.
Yeah.
And I mean, yeah, there might be one or two that are okay, but by the time it was done, by the time we kind of got ourselves together and said, you know, yeah, maybe we'll do something, it was like, no, we're already past it. But not in the way that you move past things, but you can kind of still pick here and there. It's like, no, we're bet. Like, I'm not this songwriter anymore.
Yeah.
Like, I have become, you know, I became a more mature writer. Like, so it went from not knowing how to sing or play or write to knowing how to sing and play and write to knowing how to really put together a song that's going to stick.
Yeah. And it was funny, when I was kind of going, as I was doing my research for this and going back and listening to like that first record that you guys put out, the Face Forward, and let me know, I at least first stuff that I can find out there, and this is in the Paper Jets.
Yeah.
And I listen to those songs and I think to myself, like, well, these are good. I'm like, you can hear what is, at least for you as a writer, like, and I'm assuming you wrote most of the songs for that record.
I didn't.
Oh.
Because we had the other record still, like that other one.
Oh, okay.
So most of my songs were on that. The first half was a lot of Bill.
Okay.
Who we've had on here before.
Yeah. I just remember listening to these songs and thinking, like, this is good and this is tight. Like,
and I had two on the back half.
Yeah. I'm like, this is tight. It reminded me a little more singer-songwriter than what it would be later, because then you jump to that, the EP. Well, no, you do the full length, We're All Strange.
Yeah, Strange Friends.
Which is, We're All Strange Friends, which is a really, I found to be like a very interesting sort of homage to all these different periods and stuff, while still being, and I'm not saying you guys like made a copycat covers record, but like you could definitely hear, like, this is the Big Starry song, and this is the Beach Boysy song, and that's great, because you had that sophisticated knowledge and just well to pull from of being like, I can go like this. That's the best way to learn how to write songs, to be like, well, I'm going to write an Elliott Smith song, I'm going to write or like, what would a song by an artist I like, if, you know, with my limitations, you know.
Yeah, I mean, it was not conscious.
No, but when
it was,
you can't write in a vacuum, so.
I mean, there were definitely, I think the first song on the Strange Friends record, Cooking Up an Accident, that was like, and I'm no piano player, but I was sitting in my aunt's old piano. I'd gone up to visit her in Massachusetts. She had this really crazy, like, big old house in Rockport, which is about an hour north of Boston. This is old upright. And just kind of plunking out that song, you know, three fingers and the one, you know, on there, like the dinosaur claws on the piano.
Do you play piano left-handed? Do you lead left-handed as well? So you're, okay, because for me, my better hand's my left, which is always on the lower end.
Yeah.
So I tend to lead on the lower end a little more and just kind of play staccato stuff on the high.
No, but, I'm naturally right-handed. I just play guitar lefty because it's more comfortable.
Oh, okay. But you were naturally right-handed.
Yeah.
But when I think in the last week was the first time I ever really listened to Almost Nine. And when I listened to Almost Nine, I was just like, I like it a lot. I think it's great.
That's so fun. Everybody really likes that
one. Well, because like, as I listen to it, it's pretty cohesive from start to finish. And you dial into like my sweet spot, which is like that 90s,
that
90s power pop. Not just 90s rock, because what is the 90s, but simply a set of years between 1990 and 1999. But like, there's that era of like radio hit power pop of like, and I'm not even just talking like, there's Gin Blossoms, but also
just gonna say the Gin Blossoms,
but the Toadies and the Posies and like all that stuff, and bands like Sloan and things like that. Like,
I know, and I love that. I love the Posies. I love Sloan. And I tried to open for Sloan once, but they never answered me. I just talk about not getting invited to the party. I literally like found whoever did things for them, and I'm like, hey,
I'll open.
I would love to open for you guys. I promise it's going to be great.
Oh, that would have been fun.
I should probably try it again because now at least I got stuff.
They're still kicking around.
They're great.
They put out their 12th record this year.
It's very good too.
It is good. I saw them when they came through Boot and Saddle. They played two sets. It was outstanding.
Fantastic band.
But as you move through time and you're making these records and you're, like I said, it's sort of this accelerated songwriting education too for you as well. Like, do you feel like...
There's a big jump between Face Forward and Strange Friends, I would say.
Yeah.
Big jump. And that to me was going the, here's me learning, like, I've learned how to make verses and choruses to, I've learned how to put a piece of material together.
Yeah.
And I can now start like... waving my hands in the air and making it sound how I want to sound.
Yeah, instead of like scratching head being like, doesn't sound like what's in my head.
Making it feel how I want it to feel and evoking something out of it. And Strange Friends was really cathartic. Like it needed to be made. If I made it now, it wouldn't be as effective. Yeah. It needed to be made when it was made. And that's the one I'll always go back to for me. For some reason, and I just completely, like I dictated it. I'm like, I'm going to make an album. It's going to be called We Are All Strange Friends, and every single song is going to be lyrically kind of about that, and certain themes are going to call back to others. And really, I could say this now. I mean, Bill was already out of the band, and we kind of let him go. And that's public knowledge. Yeah. Like, and we're all,
I think you told me that too.
Yeah, and we're buds. You know, we do a podcast together, and he's gonna play our show with us because it's gonna be the last Paper Jets show.
Well, yeah, that was my next. That's I've got that written down too. I had read somewhere either you had told me or maybe I had read something on social media where like this record comes out and you're just like, and we're done.
Yep, we're done.
Yeah,
that's it. Done-zo. But
from what I'm listening to on the new record, and we should talk about that. What is it? Calling it Night.
Every Day Forever.
Every Day Forever. And I listened to the two tunes that you guys have out on it right now. Mm-hmm. I had heard Charlie, It Can't Be Done. You played that for me you played that on the show.
Yeah, over 2 years ago. Yeah.
And that to me was such an amazing, like when I heard you play that and I'd said to somebody, I go, this is my new favorite song about Elvis.
How many songs about Elvis are out
My old favorite song about Elvis before that was Elvis Is Everywhere by Mojo Nixon.
Okay, I mean, I can't argue with that.
But your song is more earnest and like in a little bit more serious themed, where Elvis Is Everywhere is basically a big funny rockabilly tune.
Well, it's about Elvis, but it's more just about like what happens when you run out, when your friendship kind of, you know, when the fuel tank goes empty.
Yeah.
and you got nothing else.
Yeah.
Like, it's about a sort of a one-dimensional relationship, you know, and it's a friendship that you bond over one specific thing and then somebody moves on, or it's a relationship where, like, you're great friends, but the sex is terrible, or the sex is great, but you hate each other otherwise, you know, or like a job that, you know, maybe you kind of enjoyed for the newness of it. And now you're like, ugh, God, get me out of here.
Yeah.
And it's just one can't command the same attention and the other now can no longer demand the same level of attention. Yeah. As they, and it switches perspectives at, you know, kind of at the end. And I hate to be like, I'm not going to speak to the quality of the song, but it was written the way it was written on purpose. Like, there are no accidents in that song or on any of the songs on this record.
Yeah. I just remember when you played that on the show back 2 years ago. Mm-hmm. And me being very, very taken with this. I was like, this is a remarkable little piece of work right here.
Now I don't think where I wish I was invited to more stuff.
But I didn't know you that well at the time, and especially not as a songwriter. I knew you as a guy with a podcast who was as big a record nerd as I was. So, like, to me, I was just like, well, okay, well, this will work. Like, and then you played that song, and I don't think I'd really listened to much of your music beforehand.
You're not alone, sir.
Before I had you on that show, like, I could have gone on and, like, listened to the stuff that was on the internet. But I think in that moment, I was like, well, let me just see what he'll do. Like,
I like that. I like that. That's moxie, man.
But I knew in my head, he seems like a serious enough dude that he's not going to bring anything half-assed. So whatever he brings to me is going to be a true manifestation of what he can do. And I'm like, let's find out what that is.
Wow. Well, thank you.
And then you did it. And I was just like, and then in the back of my head, I remember when I was editing later, I thought to myself, like, I had no fucking idea it was going to be that good.
Thank you. That's very, that's very flattering.
Well, again, not in a way where I thought it wouldn't be good, but I was like, oh, I didn't think it was going to be that good. I should emphasize on that. I didn't think it was going to be that good.
I didn't think it was going to be that good.
Yeah. And that song kind of hit around in my head for like the last 2 years, like just kind of back there, me thinking like, it's a good, like, no, it's like, that's a good tune. I'm like, it's a good Elvis tune right there. It's a good tune about the subject of Elvis, of which hundreds and thousands of words have been spilled over history. I'm like,
what's from a Bill Hicks?
Well,
bit.
yeah, the thing about the scarves in the water.
Yeah, yeah. And the bit is really funny. And I mean, Bill Hicks was brilliant, and he's one of those that, like, he died when he was like 32. He's one of those. He's like a Kennedy. Like, he's one of those that was just on the hit list.
Yeah.
Like, they were just like, you know, the government was like, this guy knows too much. We got to get rid of him.
Yeah.
You know, put it in the water so that they'll never know. Like, just put it in the water, feed him something. But he, it was this bit. We're just talking about the guy Charlie Hodge, who is real, who's a real guy, who's Elvis' stage manager.
Yeah.
Who would also just stand there and hold a microphone when Elvis didn't feel like holding. No mic stands. It was a guy. He had a human being.
A human mic stand.
Do that. Talk about getting your job automated. Like, oh yeah, we got mic stands now, Charlie. Like, that's our, you know, people aren't lamplighters anymore either.
Yeah.
But so he goes up and, you know, the bit is like, oh yeah, well, you know, I got Earl and Dwayne bringing me scarves and water each night. It's like, but what if I were to bring you both your scarves and your water at the same time? And the title and the bit, you know, Hicks is just like, and I said, Charlie, it can't be done. And I'm like, and just that, sometimes that'll just hit just somebody saying something. And he's like, yeah. And I said, Charlie, it can't be done. And it just stayed in my head for a while. And I was in New Orleans at the time, and I didn't really have a guitar or a piano to kind of go to. So I just kind of kept that in my head. I'm like, Charlie, it can't be done. And I'm like, Charlie. And it's a very rhythmic sort of like, Charlie, it can't be done. Like, it's just, I'm like, how could I turn that into something?
Yeah. And sometimes that stuff sits around for a little bit and you just, and then.
And it was, that was August of 2014. So just to give you an idea of how long some of these things gestate sometimes, I was able to demo it out by November of 2015.
Yeah.
So that it took a while. Like, it takes me a while sometimes.
And then when did you do it on the show? It was in 2016. Or...
Yeah, spring of 2016.
Yeah, spring of 2016. I think. Yeah.
So I had already had
You had played it out a little bit. It definitely, when you played it for me the first time in front of me, I was like, oh, well, he's clearly done this before, too.
Yeah. Yeah. Absolutely.
Yeah. Well, it's funny, too, because sometimes you meet people who are just like, yeah, I've been in bands. I have a band. And that statement can really run the gamut of, like, of quality.
I don't trust people who are, I mean, well, I shouldn't say that because you've been in bands. Yeah. So, like, but when someone's like, oh, yeah, no, I'm just in bands. I've just been in bands and this and that. It's like, I don't always trust the quality. I should say that. Yeah. I don't always.
Yeah.
Trust the quality of the songwriting of someone who's been in bands. I've been in a band for 10 years.
Yeah,
I've been in other projects and things, but like the mains, you know, it's like we're in an open relationship. We're in like a polyamorous.
Yeah.
Like they let me be with other musicians.
Yeah.
You know, as long as like I come home and spoon them at the end of the night.
How did you meet the guys? I know your drummer was
we were
there,
college
was there at the beginning.
Yeah, we did an independent study together in college, and we recorded an album back then in 2005.
Yeah.
We just recorded 10 songs, and we almost put it out. We put it out for like a we put out about half of it for like a little bit, and then we're like, this was a bad idea, and then we stopped. I was like, this is a bad idea, and I just pulled it. I don't even think I told him right away. I was like, yeah, I pulled that.
Yeah,
that's not anywhere anymore. And he's like, oh, okay.
That's Frank, right?
Frank, yeah, Frank Lettieri Jr.
Yeah,
and Bill, who we do the Great Albums podcast together. He was also a college buddy. It was really the three of us. And eventually, you know, Bill knew Scotty, the bass player from, you know, bands he had played in, brought him in. You know, it's public knowledge. We asked Bill to leave because we were both in kind of weird places.
Yeah.
In our like weird post-relationship places that made Bill and I both sort of act out against one another.
Yeah.
And this is not, again, like there's actually a great podcast called the Failed Musicians Podcast.
That's a good one already.
That Bill was a guest on, and he kind of tells the story, and I'm not here to be the, you know, the Jeff Tweedy to his Jay Farrar. Or Farrar? Farrar? Farrar.
I always said Farrar. Farrar.
Yeah. So I'm not here to Tweety his Farrar.
Yeah.
I will accept Bill's version of the story as canon because I don't really have a different view of it.
Yeah.
Because his side, you know, he was like, he kind of, what he explained was he's like, yeah, we were both kind of in weird places and, you know, acting strangely toward one another, maybe because like other things, we didn't know how to really process all this other stuff that was going on in our lives personally. And so, you know, somebody just had to go.
Yeah.
It was, you know, and it was like, you know, it was harder to find a drummer. Like it was not, you know, not to sound insensitive, but again, like, you know, Bill and I are great friends now, and like I'm
glad.
Sometimes
that really works, though. Like you, when you stop being in a band with someone, you're just like, "Oh, wait, this is probably why I liked you originally."
Yeah, and I mean the same thing. Bill showed me like most of the stuff that really got me started on that like musical journey. Like I owe almost all of it to Bill, and it sucked. And like I didn't know what else to say or how to continue. I didn't know what to say to Bill to make what we were doing together okay to do together anymore.
Yeah.
So it just was like, yeah. And it's a really hard conversation to have, and it sucked. And we didn't talk for 2 years. And finally sat down and like really hashed it out. You know, I think like you said, it kind of brought us together a little bit more.
Yeah.
So that just had to go. So now we got Mike Virac on guitar, and actually brought in another bass player named Scott, Scott Miller, who's from Philly, actually. And we've kind of, that's been the lineup for a couple of years now. So it's, and you know, that's bands. And I don't know how people retain members because it's very difficult.
Yeah, it is. And especially when you're not able to like be fully on financially successful, You start dropping people by the wayside, so they're just like, well, I got to go to grad school, so, you know, I'm out.
Or I got a promotion, and now I make, like, real money.
Yeah, or, hey, we just had a kid, you know, and I can't be out late because I literally cannot sleep enough and my brain is exploding.
Correct, yeah.
Yeah. I've seen a lot of guys do it that way. Thankfully, a lot of times the good ones who kind of go out for whatever life reasons it seems, if it's in them, they come back around again.
Yeah.
I've met a lot of people my age and even older who, you know, once their kids get a little older, they're able to leave them and like, they're just like, oh, well, hey, you want to put the band back together or you want to put a band back together?
Yeah.
And it's not old and sad like dad rock, you know?
You know what?
Not that dad rock is old and sad, but like it's that sort of cliche of, you know, thinning hair, beer belly guys.
I've definitely got the thinning hair. The beer belly, I don't drink that much, but it's, you know, it's the food belly.
The food belly.
Because I love to eat, and I love to eat good food. So not so much the beer belly, but just the... I just love food. I love good food, but I also love good, like, good bad food, you know, good, like a good, you know, like a good sandwich like that. Just like, I don't need something crazy, but just something that's like satisfying.
Yeah. So these guys are all on the record too. The newer guys that have been part of the lineup.
Yeah.
Am I wrong in thinking that record took a really long time?
Yeah, what I've realized is, and I'm trying to head it, and I have a new project already because it's going to be the Paper Jets last show. So, like, I had a new project kind of just manifest out of a one-off, like, that the Paper Jets couldn't make. So I found, like, a bassist and a drummer, played a show under my own name.
Yeah.
Had, like, a couple of extra songs kind of just kicking around that weren't necessarily suitable for the Jets, or at least not for this record. So taught the other guys... did this show and they liked it. And so now basically the point is we've already started recording that stuff. So I'm going to try to head off my own bad habits by being like, I'm not going to take 4 years to make a record.
I was sort of watching you record this record for like almost the amount of time that I've
that
known you.
That you've known me.
Yeah.
We met in July of 2016.
That was right. Yeah.
And in July of 2016 is when we first pressed record on this album.
Okay.
So it's the entirety of yours and my, you know, relationship as podcasters and as friends. We have been recording this album.
Yeah. There's a lot of reasons for a record to take that long, especially at the level that you're at where everyone's got jobs and, you know, things that they have to do. So that can, of course... making a record take longer. I'm curious, when you guys went into it originally and then kind of what you came out with in the end, did you feel like you had kind of, it was just an elongated process, or did you find yourself in the end being like, oh, well, this isn't where we expect it to be?
No, it sounded like how we thought it would sound.
It just, over the course of a bit.
Frank lost his grandfather.
Frank
lost his grandfather right before we started recording, and right after we finished, I think it was, he lost his grandmother. Both, you know, same side of the family. It was his maternal grandparents.
Yeah.
And they both, he was very close with them. You know, kind of had a hand in, not raised him, but were there.
Well, yeah.
Like they were active grandparents. Yeah.
The big extended family.
Yeah. Like they were, you know, you consider, you know, your grandparents your immediately extended family. Like that was more like his extended immediate family. Like they were always around.
Yeah.
And they had a real big influence. So it was almost, to him, it was almost like losing another parent, kind of. It was like it had that type of impact.
Yeah.
So, you know, when he lost his grandfather, we decided to take a break from the band that lasted almost a year. And so we kind of got started on the project late, like that pushed it by a year. Nobody's fault, no anger or anything, just stating a fact. And then his grandmother was suffering from both Alzheimer's and Parkinson's and came to live with him. And his mom and his brother. And so they all kind of got together and were taking care of her for the entire time that we were also trying to get in there and rehearse and record the record. And it was just, I can't imagine the level of emotional exhaustion that he must have felt, because we also decided that that it was going to be Frank that was going to do it, because he had kind of come along, like strange friends, like I engineered some of that. I had a hand in recording a lot of that, and it kind of shows because I don't know what I'm doing. And it sounds very particular, but some might say it doesn't sound very good. Whereas this, I think it's indisputable. Whatever you think of the quality of the material, you can't argue that it doesn't sound excellent.
No, I did, just from the two tracks that are out there right now, and they're two very different sounding songs. Yeah. But when you listen to them back to back, I'm like, okay. Just in listening to those two together, I was like, I think I can see that that the whole record is going to kind of have this sort of sonic glue happening.
Yeah. Oh, totally. Yeah. And so to have that, and because we knew Frank would be able to do it.
Yeah.
You know, be able to kind of succeed where I'd even say I failed.
Yeah. It's hard to engineer your own stuff, and especially if you're the writer and then you're also trying to engineer it, that can get super difficult.
I was just trying to make it sound like weird. So, but there would be, you know, you would look at a track, right? And there would be in Strange Friends, if you were to look at the multi tracks, there would be one track where it'd just be silence, 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 and then there would just be a boom, like a 10-second long guitar kind of drone.
Drone hit, yeah.
And that's it. And it's like, it's one of those where it's like, I know it's there, but you know, but things like that, it's like, is that really necessary?
Yeah.
And so it's like, we're going to, you know, take this away from this person and give it to this more capable person that can get the record done and not sort of sit with the little peccadilloes and you know, fuss over those like I was doing.
You're getting a little Lindsey Buckingham on it, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. And that wasn't necessarily good. That's not what this record really needed.
Yeah.
So Frank kind of shepherded it in a great way, but suffered this really, really hard, these hard losses, both in the very beginning and at the very end of the process, that throughout were affecting him. And, you know, I feel like sometimes maybe I wasn't quite as sensitive as I should have been, because I just didn't know. Because Frank's also a very, like, you know, he's a very resolute guy. He's very stoic. He's a great guy. But sometimes it's hard to know where he's coming from.
Yeah.
You know, you come in and he's like, hey, how's it going? Let's get to work. And we work, and then we leave, and then I leave, and that's it. You know, but like there had to have been all this stuff swimming around in his mind. And that's okay. You know, and I always took it to be like, all right, well, you know, we're over here working, so it must be okay to be over here working right now.
Yeah.
But, you know, some days it was like he'd call or he'd text and be like, not today, guys, not tonight.
Yeah. Because you're doing all this out of the house.
Yeah. 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 He built, like, and that's the thing. Like, he put up walls. He did soundproofing. He's got a cloud over his drum set now. Like, although we did drums here in Philly at Spice House, but for his own future recordings, whatever he does, like, he installed a cloud now in his own house. I'm like, so he's serious about this, but it must have been so hard. And so for me as the, you know, as the public steward, because, you know, the other guys, you know, like Scott lives here in Philly, so he doesn't really go out to like the other shows. Mike's got his guitar shop. Frank's doing his thing. Frank's a videographer by trade, which is a very deadline oriented, high pressure job that switches directions very quickly. So he's got that, and he's working on a record, and he's got family. So it just, this is not blaming. Like, this is just like, I don't know how I wouldn't have been able to keep myself together.
Yeah.
Like, I would have probably exploded at the other guys if they were like, hey, can we record tonight? Can we record tonight? Can we? If they were as much of a pain in the ass as I know I am or can be, like I would have shut the whole I would have been like, here's the Maltese.
We're done. Yeah.
You know, here's the Maltese. There's the band fund. Just call me when we're done because I just can't.
Yeah.
And I mean, the fact that he was able to keep it together and make the record sound as good as it sounds is remarkable. And you know what? If this really is our last show, I can't blame him for wanting a break.
Yeah.
Because he really deserves it. And I mean, he's stuck with me for 15 years almost now. So, I mean, it's the longest relationship I've ever had outside of my family.
Yeah.
And like, honestly, like, I wouldn't want to be with me for that long.
I don't think that's... I just think at some point, as you work towards a thing, especially at this level of bands where like there's no immediate payoff, both literally or figuratively, other than the payoff of just enjoying the work and enjoying, you know, playing together. At some point, it's true. Like, if you've been playing together for that long, it's nice to kind of be like, all right, and let's... It's not even like we're done. I don't imagine it's the last time you'll ever play with Frank again. But
he already actually offered to mix the new group I'm doing.
There you go. So, and that's sort of...
So it's kind of funny that he's like, even though we're not going to do this, it's like, I'd still like a hand in some of this stuff.
And I think that's a good hand to have in there. Someone who's just like, yeah, but I've been listening to you for 15 years, so let me kind of just, you know...
Yeah.
Yeah. It's good to have all different levels of perspective kind of coming in on all on all parts of a project. You've got new people, because there's that joy and fun of like playing, newly playing together where everyone's just kind of vibing off each other and figuring it out. And then it's nice also in that project to have someone else to come in who's like kind of been there in the long haul.
Oh, yeah. And you know, I find though with a new project, and I approach a lot of my relationships this way, is it's almost like at this point I'm such a sucker sometimes for the newness of things.
Yeah.
And I mean, you know, friends, romance, you know, work, musical projects, art related, you know, writing, the talk show, things like that. And I like doing all these things, but to me it's like, let's see. I'm almost now, you know, because people love the honeymoon phase of things, right?
Yeah.
People love when you're just like, you know, you're in a band, you're working every day, you're texting, you're sending stuff back. What about this? What about this? What about this? You're in a relationship. You see each other every single day. I'm not interested in that. Like, let's skip ahead 6 months and see if we still like each other.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, it's like, I'm 35 years old. So it's like, you know what? I could fall in love, I could, you know, with a project, and in 6 months be like, this is terrible, and I hate these people. So it's like, I almost want to just drop the knowledge on anybody and be like, look, here's the deal. Like, I got this stuff, this is what I want to do. Like, can we please just skip ahead from the newness and excitement? Can we just start practicing? Can we start playing?
Yeah.
Let's start playing. We got 5 songs. Give me like that 20-minute opening spot.
Yeah.
We got 7 songs. Okay, I could stretch that into 30 minutes.
Yeah.
Like, you know, we got 9 songs. All right, now we got a 40-minute set. Like, and it's like, let's just go now. Let's do it now. Let's fuck up now. Let's get mad now. Like, let me tell you where you missed that hit. Now, you tell me where I messed up that solo now.
Yeah.
Like, don't be in love with this stuff. Tell me what you really think.
Because there's only so much time.
Yeah. Like, it's like, I don't...
Don't spare my feelings. I mean, you know, like, be respectful and be polite. You know, be...
You don't have to be
good.
Polite.
Well, I mean, not polite, but just, you know, be respectful. Be good people to each other. But don't spare my feelings. If you think that sucked, if you think I could sing that better, you know.
Just tell me.
Be like, hey, that wasn't bad, but I've heard you do it better. So let's run that again, you know?
Yeah.
Because so many, and I can come at this from like, you know, from being in projects too with people.
It's
that
almost
I've known.
Like, don't patronize me and tell me this is fine.
Yeah.
Don't insult me.
Don't everyone finish the tune in rehearsal. And you can just tell, it's palpable sometimes in a room. It's like, that didn't go great. And then someone will be like, well, let's move on. And I'm just like, no. Before we move on, let's acknowledge what happened.
Yep.
And if we can fix it by doing it again, let's do it again. If we can't fix it by doing it again, then let's not do it again and let's move on. But let's not just move on because nobody wants to say, hey, I didn't like that. Did you not like that?
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
It is a joy to like be in a room with people who can hopefully, and it's hard to get that level of honesty right off the bat.
And it's hard. Because are people like, are human beings like as animals, like naturally communicative? Because it feels like it's such an effort. And that to me, it doesn't feel like we are.
That's an interesting way to think about it.
Is the human animal a naturally communicative being? Because I don't know if it is, because it's so much easier not to, that it almost feels unnatural when you have to like stop and reassess and reevaluate and say, okay, this, we did this right, we did this wrong, in any set, in a band, in a, you know, with kids. I don't have kids.
Yeah. Or just with coworkers, out in the world,
a spouse or a partner, or
friends, yeah,
yeah. And it's like, I wonder, you know, it's so much easier to just let it go. But then you end up doing what I do,
blowing the whole thing up,
and that's it.
Yeah, there needs to be some, and I think it comes with age too, and like getting in bands. And I was telling you off mic, just sort of disappointments I've had lately, and trying to be part of other projects or, you know, kind of get maybe something of mine going, is that when you get older, you're just like, let's go now. And not in a let's go now in a desperate way, but just be like, let's get to the part where we can just, where the level of quality and enjoyment will be equal and we can just coast on that for a while.
Yeah.
Let's get to the point where, and it's, you understand that, like, you know, for any band to be good, just like, well, we have to play with each other for an amount of time that needs to gel. As people get older, they become better musicians and like can kind of gel quicker, but you still, there's an incubating period.
You know, we had the talk like a couple months ago, and we said hiatus maybe, this, and I'm like, I hate the hiatus thing.
Yeah.
So we kind of said what we sort of did was, I, at the very last practice last week, I was like, fellas, let's just call it. Just call it.
Yeah.
Just say it's going to be our last. I'd say it's going to be our last show.
Yeah.
And that doesn't necessarily mean it's going to be our last record.
Or our last whatever collaboration that means.
And that, so it's like, that's a very, I come from a family of like, psychologists, therapists. I got an attorney in there. You know, there's a lawyer in this. So it's like, that's a very like, where it's like, oh, they're never going to do anything. It's like, no. We just said that's going to be our last show.
Yeah.
That doesn't mean that's going to be our last record. That doesn't mean, you know, you're not going to hear from it. Just means
it's our last show. Yeah.
But at the end of the day, though, it still feels like, because it, basically part of it was, you know, somebody goes, well, you know, same thing as I said, you know, I'm 35 years old and this and that, but it's like, oh yeah, well, you know, I'm getting older, I'm getting tired, and I've got this, I got this, I got this. And someone else is like, you know, I'm getting older, we're not making any money, I'm driving here, I'm driving there, it's just not worth the time.
Yeah.
And, you know, to me, like, it's, and there's no wrong answer. There's no one is, because to somebody that looks at doing music with practicality, what I do makes no sense.
I absolutely know where you're coming from.
Seen there was like a meme. A musician will put, will shove like $2,000 worth of equipment into a $1,000 car to drive 500 miles to play a free show.
Yeah. yeah.
And it's like, you know what? Yeah. I will every single time. And actually I'm gonna add a caveat to that. I've been a little more choosy. I'm not gonna play just anything. But if I think it's worth it, if I feel like it's worth it, and not even for the exposure, if I feel like it's worth it for the enjoyment.
Yeah, if you're just like, yeah, that'll be fun.
That's gonna be great.
Yeah.
If that to me, because to me it's like life to me, because I'm not married, I don't have kids. You know, to me, it's like, and I'm not much of like a carouser either.
Yeah.
So to me, it's like, if a good time is going to be had, like if I'm going to just get some type of fulfillment out of going to this show and playing, then I'll do it.
Yeah.
With no ulterior motive, with just the fulfillment of playing a good show. That's the to me, music is its own reward. And I'm not saying that others to the more practically minded people that it's not its own reward. But I almost feel like to those, you know, to somebody who plays in a cover band, you know, they're walking away. I'm playing a show in Wayne next Friday, which I don't think is going to be out by then. But we're talking to Friday, November 2nd.
Yeah.
And that's, you know, a good like hour and a half, 2 hours from where I live. And I'm going to go there.
It's 40 minutes from where we are right now.
Yeah. And I'm going to go there and I'm going to play. And I'm just playing by myself. And I'm going to, you know, get a beer or two. And then I'm going to, when at the end of the night, after the last person plays, I'm going to go before it starts. And I'm going to stay till after it's done. And I drive home at like 1 a.m. and get home at like 3.
Sleep for a few hours and then get up and go to work.
Sleep for like 4 hours and then that's it. And the next day I just proceed with my day.
Yeah.
You know, and that's okay. And to somebody who's figured out how to make some money, they're going to play covers for a couple hours and they're going to, you know, they're going to walk out with $500 and I'm just going to walk out with, you know, a couple hundred more miles on not that old car that already has a whole lot of mileage on it.
Yeah.
And, you know, a few bucks poorer and, you know, and that, but that's okay because everybody has different reasons. Like, yeah. I want to make it clear I'm not disparaging other people's reasons for doing things and not doing things.
Because in the end,
trying to make clear my own reasons.
And in the end, that cover band guy is very likely deriving the amount of enjoyment out of it that you are deriving out of your thing. And in the end, kind of like when you take money aside and be like, are you both having a good time? And if the answer is yeah, you're just like, okay.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, and there's nothing wrong with that. Yeah. And you know what? Maybe if someone's like, well, the guy that made money, like, maybe, you know, it's like, maybe I'm the, you know, maybe I'm the crazy one. Maybe I'm the you know, the sane man in the insane world here where it's like, oh, yeah, that's it.
Yeah.
Like, yeah, I'm the one that's messing up. I'm the one that's failing because I'm the one that's like playing to empty rooms for disinterested folks, putting out a record, basically throwing a record into the void, let's be honest.
That is
like,
true. Yeah.
I hope people listen to it. I mean, really? Like, I don't know, listen. Like, we have like 100 plays on YouTube for that thing. Like, so who's listening? My mom probably listened like 5 times. You said you listened once.
Yep.
So there's 6 right there. I've probably listened to it like 3 times. So there we go. We got 10 right there.
Well, I don't know. I think it's important to keep making the work, though, in whatever form that is. Even if it's not paper jets, it's this new thing or whatever. And
I'm holding off on saying the new, because I want to. Well, the new thing, it's called The Extensions. That's the new band.
Okay.
But it's you know, because we get the paper jets record, and that's the sort of wind down here. When The Extensions, you'll get The Extensions record whenever that happens.
Yeah.
But that's a bit far off right now.
Well, I'm glad you guys are kind of going out in a way that you want to. Everyone seems to be everyone's on board with this way. And that's
and Bill's going to play with us too, which is awesome.
Yeah, and you play Asbury Lanes, which is freaking great.
Yeah. And that's it was important to us too to have Bill come back and play with us.
Kind of everything's sort of coming full circle.
Yeah. And to say, you know, yeah, Bill and I, we got the podcast, we're all friends. Frank actually produced a record that Bill did afterward with a different project.
The Small Planet Radio stuff.
And the Bootstrap Bandits.
Oh, okay. Actually, I didn't know there was another project.
Very short-lived.
Yeah.
They did like 2 EPs. But Frank, you know, he got Frank to play drums and record one for. So like there's been a lot of crossover.
Yeah. It's all part of the larger community.
Yeah, like, but it'd be nice to have Bill like on stage with us doing a couple songs. And he's going to learn a couple. I talked to him just today. Like we're going to have him do 2 old ones. And he's like, no, I'll learn a couple of the newer ones, and we're going to play like what was supposed to be 2 songs. I think we're going to end up doing like maybe 5 or 6.
Great.
And, you know, kind of with at the end of the set. So kind of like bring him back and close out the night with the current lineup and our founding.
Yeah.
You know, the guy who used to knock on my dorm room door and come in with his guitar and be like, hey, man, you busy? You want to do some music? Like, so, you know, talk about bringing it right back.
Yeah.
Like that'd be, it's a pleasure and an honor that he, you know, would say yes to that.
I think that's a great way to bring it back around in this conversation as well. But did you want to play something?
Sure.
Yeah. All right. Let's get that set up. All right. What one do you want to do here?
Well, this is one of the two that are currently available. It's called Chatter. Clothes don't fit like they did. Look me up and down now, kid. Go pretend means to end. Convince parents left for dead. Refuse to settle down. Convince you never settle for me. Head off to the runaround. At least that's where I think you're going. Stop this climb, yours and mine. Wasted water, waste of time. Refuse to settle down. Convince you never settle for me. Head off to the runaround. At least that's where I think you're.
Awesome.
There we go.
I didn't know, I was like, is it done or is this like a thing?
No,
where
no,
it's
done. The solo version is quick.
Yeah.
The album version, we have a little solo.
Yeah.
Viroc does a great little slide guitar part.
Yeah,
there.
Yeah. No, I'd heard it. No, I never know. Sometimes in songs, I'm like, is this for dramatic effect? Do we have to be quiet? And then it's coming back in?
No.
All right. You want to try another one too? Try another one. That's such a condescending. You want to try and do a song, Brian?
Yeah. Well, with me, it's mostly accurate. Yeah. Just try. All we can do. All we can do. The best we can do is try. Can we? Yeah, this song is called Wonderful Love, and this is an interesting one. Because if Strange Friends was sort of the autobiographical one where it was just things I needed to like get out. This has been a lot more observational. So, like, even though I still tend to sing in the first person, like, it's gotten a lot more.
It's got less to do with you.
Yeah.
Or less to be about, specifically about.
Yeah.
Your specific experiences.
Yeah. So, like, I just kind of, you know, it's a sort of people watch kind of experience. And this one is sort of about how no matter how hard you try, you know, we all end up kind of just remaining largely the same person. And it kind of sucks if that same person is like not such a good person. So, you know, here's me judging others, but, you know, that's what it is. And it's about letting somebody else attempt to change that person. So, and then, you know, you not letting it change you. And maybe that's not always so good. So. Well,
stranger land, population 2 or 3, where you and I apologize. Who I used to be, I am a stranger man on the corner, sing my songs while you and he make memories to last the hour long. Look up, step back, you never could relax. The rules you made, you've broken all them anyway. The pain you feel, you reach for something beautiful, but I will always miss your wonderful love. I got a message for anyone who drags me out, and so I go to see what you believe. You told me all about the conversation goes on and on for days at a time, while you go through the untold truths, among them yours and mine. Look up, step back, you never could relax. The rules you made, you've broken all them anyway. The pain you feel, you reach for something pitiful, but I will always miss your wonderful love.
Great.
Thanks.
That's on the new record too?
Yep.
Awesome.
Track two.
Mm-hmm. That's the one. That's when you find out. That's track two. Because track one's all like, yeah. And then track two is like, all right, let's see what this whole thing's going to be like.
Well, that's, track one comes out like gangbusters. Yeah. It's an up-tempo kind of song. And
you
got to
start
two,
strong.
Yeah. What we meant.
And end strong, too. You got to do both.
I hope so. We ended with a 7-minute song.
Oh, that's very Weezer right there.
It calls back. We call back to that Charlie It Can't Be Done song, too. We do a reprise. We had never done.
Oh, like a reprise.
Like if we're going to, if you're going to be in a band, if you're going to call it, right? If you're going to call it, you got to do a few things. You got to have a song with a time change. You got to have a song with a key change. And you got to have one with a reprise.
There you go. Awesome, Brian. Thank you so much for coming, dude.
Thanks for having me.
Yep. We'll be together till the end of time. 24 hours long. Well, that's the show for this week. Thank you so much for hanging out. Thank you for listening. Thank you, Brian Erickson, for being on the show, for being a good dude. Driving all the way down from wherever it is that he lives in New Jersey. It's not close. Great to talk to him. He and Bill from the Great Elms podcast are probably, and I don't have a ton of these, but they are definitely two like people that I consider not just friends, but like podcast colleagues. I don't have a lot of those, but they are definitely two of them. Like I said at the top of the show, The Paper Jets at thepaperjets.com. Go there, find out everything about them. They have a brand new record, Every Day Forever, coming out on December 7th. That's a Friday. In conjunction with their record release party on December 7th, which is a Friday. See, that was good. Good job, guys. At Asbury Lanes up in Asbury Park, New Jersey. That's a great venue. I'm hearing a lot of good stuff about it. I'm going to go up there. I'm going to see the show. It'll be my first time at Asbury Lanes and only my second time in Asbury Park ever. So it's special. Check out all that information again at thepaperjets.com. Get your tickets. Listen to their other records, which are all outstanding. Get to know the band. Get to know them well. Thanks so much for listening. My name is Dan Drago. This is 25 O'Clock, Philadelphia's longest-running musical podcast, I think. Until next time, take care of yourselves.